Apparently they're different colors.
I didn't know there was a different color that means.
Alright. Just found a little bit of background on Nelson. Here we are at Bruce's Brigade Tablet. We all know a little bit about Nelson, this bombastic big old huge. He's like 300 pounds, what, 6 foot, whatever, bull Nelson. he's the one, of course, that was shot by Jefferson Davis, not the Jefferson Davis, but yeah, the Galt Hotel. Yeah. The whole thing about one of them, he had insulted him, he slapped him and spit on him and all that kind of stuff, you know, whole thing there. At any rate, Nelson leads the advance of the Army of the Ohio from Nashville. Well, he doesn't lead the advance to Columbia. Somebody else leads the advance. I believe he's Crittenden or McCook, one or the other. At any rate, Nelson takes the lead then when he makes his men ford the Duck River in the freezing cold, take off all their clothes up to their necks in water, holding their guns and their cartridge boxes and all that over them. And you know, he gets across the river though, and he gets the glory, and he gets to lead the march. He's the first one in. We all know about Ammen's brigade that lands on the afternoon of April the 6th. And here, you know, as we talked about, some of the argument is Buell's forces argue that had Buell not arrived, Grant would have been destroyed and all that. Buell says he came and he saved the day. my opinion is, of course, that Buell doesn't really save anything. There are only like 12 companies of the 6 Ohio and what, the 36 Indiana, I believe, that come in, because they left some companies back at Savannah. One company of a certain regiment was left back at Columbia, in fact. So they're down a little bit, but they do cross over and they do go into action. And their tablets are a little bit farther back. This is second day morning stuff before they move out. one thing I have been really surprised at in doing the research for this book is how many of Grant's soldiers write in their letters and diaries, like a day or two or 5 days or whatever after the battle, we would have been cooked gooses if Buell hadn't got here. We would have been surrounded and had to surrender if Buell hadn't got here. They thought Buell saved the day. And Grant later on would say, no, he didn't save the day. And Buell would say, yes, I did, and all that. But Grant's soldiers literally thought Buell had saved the day. I wasn't quite aware of that level of thought there in Grant's soldiers. that doesn't change my opinion. I still don't think Buell saved the day, no matter what they thought. You know, they're kind of isolated in their little area. You know, I think sometimes who are we to argue with what they thought at the time, but I looking at the whole picture, I still don't think Buell saved the day. However, that it was very important, the morale factor and all that. So, Ammen does his thing later on. Bruce's brigade will land. the 3rd Brigade, Hazen's brigade, will land as well. Then other divisions, McCook's division comes in, Crittenden's division comes in actually before that. And then there are a couple others stacked up on behind that. Wood's brigade, or Wood's division, Thomas Wood's and George Thomas's, they'll come in a little bit later. Today we're focusing, of course, on Hazen's, or Nelson's division that contain Ammen's, Bruce's, and Hazen's brigades. Ammen and Nelson get along real well. They Nelson just gloats over Ammen in his report. Nelson and Hazen get along. Hazen is just across the ravine there. They get along pretty good, although Nelson kind of gets irritated a little bit later on, as we'll talk about when we get into the wheat field and all that. Nelson and Bruce don't get along at all. And in fact, Bruce is not going to command this brigade long. He hasn't commanded it long before this. This is the brigade, the Kentucky Brigade, 1st, 2nd, and 20th Kentucky. This will be commanded in the movement toward Corinth by Thomas Sedgwick. You may be familiar with the fighting at Surratt's Hill, the Widow Surratt's, on the creek there as they're approaching Corinth. So Bruce is not going to be around long. He has some sickness. He suffers a stroke, I believe, and he goes home. But Bruce and Nelson, there's a little bit of contention there. But they are in line here. Ammen's tablet is just over on the main trail going down to Chalmers position on the first day, and then of course we've got Hazen to the right. So we're going to follow all three of these, Ammen, Bruce, and Hazen, as we move forward. And these are the positions that they take on the morning of April the 7th. 5 o'clock or so, 5:30, just about daylight. Nelson's gonna get him moving forward. He's awake by about 4 o'clock. He's raring to go. You know, imagine Bull Nelson. And he's ready to go. And of course, the first thing they're gonna do, they're gonna step off over into Deal Branch Ravine. And as we go, how many of you have been through Dill Branch event? Let's look at that. Yeah, everybody has. Well, gosh, well, we don't need to even do
this. Not from this direction.
Not from this direction. Not from the other direction. All right, we've got a little different perspective on it.
But you said we don't have to do it, so.
If y'all don't want to, we don't have to. But at any rate, you will get kind of an idea, again, going through this direction. And imagine if the Confederates had contested their movement across here. Added to that, of course, it's rained all night. It's slippery, it's foggy, it's muddy. Keeping formation as they go across this thing. Had the Confederates resisted there, who knows what would have happened, Grant. You know, if they'd held them back for just saving 5 hours like Sherman and Prentice do, or mainly Sherman at Shiloh Branch and Locust Grove Branch, might Grant have said, well, I don't know that we can drive them away. Let's just hold here and see if they'll go away. Or potentially the next night, you know, they might have said, well, we got to get out of here. Let's withdraw. Or who knows what would happen, and that's pure conjecture. But the fact that the Confederates don't resist there allows, and this is the key, all of Buell's forces, as well as Lew Wallace and the Army of the Tennessee, the remainder of the Army of Tennessee, to get across these major impediments unchallenged and to form up again and then begin their movements. And that's why the fighting really doesn't start on the second day till 8 o'clock or 8:30 or 9. The heavy fighting doesn't start till about 9 o'clock. But the Confederates just kind of give them a free pass across here and allow them to get formed and get organized across these major ravines. And then they take it to them. But even then, on the neutral ground where the Confederates really don't have any major defensive help, I guess, or things that they can use terrain-wise in terms of defense, they still hold Buell, these fresh troops from Buell, and they're not as fresh as we think sometimes either, because they've marched like 20-something miles the day before and all of that. Especially the rear ones, McCook, I mean, they're really moving to get to Savannah and then here all night and all that. They're really tired out. But even as fresh as they are in Lew Wallace's division, as fresh as he is, the Confederates still hold them on basically neutral ground for another, from 9 until about 2 or so. They still hold them for another 5 or so hours. So again, had they contested this, I wonder if it had been any different. So to me, I guess what I was arguing a while ago, the key decisions at Shiloh are not necessarily on the first day. That puts the Grant and so on in position to make the key decisions, but any lesser commander than Grant might have made a different decision to stay number one and to counterattack number two. And only the genius of Grant, I think, will bring forward what happened on day two and make that decisive. Anyway, are we ready? You want to go across the branch with me?
Jacob Annam. I was doing research in Springfield, and they had a file Ammon's papers. And I said, oh, let me look at those. And so they bring me this file, and I rummaged through it. And they had his diary that he wrote. And it described his march from Savannah through the swamps down to crossing. It was really interesting. It was really great because he had good handwriting.
Really?
It was easy to read.
Part of his diary was published in the official records. I don't know if you've looked at that or not. But I wonder, it would be interesting to compare the two to see if there's any discrepancy, because a lot of times what you'll get is kind of a refurbished type thing that was maybe printed later or something. Always go back to the original. But that, check on that. In right behind his report in the official records is Ammon's diary.
Okay. Some of the stuff I read, I had read before.
Okay. It's a really fascinating diary. I think he's the one that talks about Nelson was just a bumble of energy at our camp this morning, waking us up or something like that.
Well, he describes how he had to find a guide.
To get from Savannah.
Until the noon or so. There was a doctor who was a unionist.
Yeah.
And he had been out on a call, and he showed up, and he was able to, or he heard about it somehow, and he said, oh, yeah, I'll take you.
Yeah.
But you have to leave the artillery and stuff.
Wheel vehicles behind.
And then Jacob Ammon was a boyhood friend of Grant.
Right. So close connections there. Yeah. All righty. Well, let's go. Uh, down through Deal Branch Ravine. He pops out into, of course, Cloud Field. Now, when he starts, of course, all three brigades are east of the River Road. But gradually, as they move forward, and that's what we're going to do, we're going to take their trek just right through, and it's not as bad on the other side of the woods. But they gradually shift over in a diagonal fashion to where two of the three brigades, Bruce's and Hazen's, are on the west side of the River Road, and only Almond is still on the left side, or the east side. We'll look at that as we go forward. The reason they don't go through there, of course, had they known, that would have been logical. Although you leave this area unprotected and you got a forming line and so on. But Crittenden is moving up on their right, of course. And then McCook a little farther to their right. Believe it or not, Nelson gets through Deal Branch Ravine and forms his line here in Cloud Field way before Crittenden and McCook even get through that gap. Remember the bottleneck that we're talking about, the neck of the hourglass kind of thing? that is just your right over there, my left. And Crittenden and McCook have a harder time getting through there and forming their lines on Nelson's right than Nelson does. In fact, Buell has to order Nelson to hold off. Hold on a little bit. This is like 6:37. Hold up until Crittenden and McCook come up and cover your right flank. And then they all have to wait on the Army of the Tennessee to move forward. Lew Wallace has moved forward into Jones Field over there, but the component that fought the day before, Sherman and McClernand and Hurlbut and that bunch, they're really, really, really slow moving through the area that we looked at earlier today. Remember, we were at Williams Tablet, Hughes Tablet there, moving through Tillman Branch and all that. It takes them, they're the last ones to get across the two major impediments, Bill and Tillman. But Nelson is one of the first to cross. He's raring to go. He's raring to take the fight to him. When he gets into Cloud Field, he meets his first Confederates. And they're skirmishers, Forrest's skirmishers, the 3rd Tennessee Cavalry. And they fire just a few shots and then drift back into the woods. So Nelson makes first contact here. As he moves forward, just barely skirmishing with the enemy, and he won't make full contact until he gets on up to Wicker. That's where we're going next. So, relatively unimpeded moving across this. Again, the Confederates resisted a little bit. Who knows what they could have done. I think they could have done more than, obviously, what they did. But, any questions for
anybody on the Confederate side? They got the order to pull back on the night of the 6th. That was standing right here, saying, you know what? It was hard when we made the attacks across and we came back. We should stay right here. Anybody argue that?
Well, not in necessarily those words, but Forrest is really the only one. Forrest is picketing this area, mm-hmm. Chalmers' brigade, which is a little farther back. Over at the Indian Mounds, he watches the famous stories of him watching Buell cross and all that. And he goes and he tells Hardy, and Hardy says, we're going to tell Ford. And he finds several other generals, and they say, well, go find Ford. Forrest can't find Ford. And he's arguing, I think his arguments are actually, we need to either get out of here because Buell is here, or we need to make a night attack right now. And of course, neither of those options are very good, and they won't choose neither of those. You don't make night attacks during the Civil War. Very rarely do you do that. And Beauregard is still of the mindset that we're going to crush them the next day. Even if Buell comes in, you know, we don't believe that, but even if Buell comes in, we're gonna crush them the next day. Even by 8:30 or 9 in the morning, Beauregard is still offensive-minded, and he has this elaborate plan. And this is what you get by piecing together his reports and staff officers' reports and all that. That's why I wondered about, who was talking about Almond's diary? You know, comparing that with someone in Beauregard's basically autobiography by Alfred Roman, the military operations of Beauregard. And, yeah. And so in the appendix back there, it has all of Beauregard's staff officers' reports by Numa Augustine and Thomas Jordan and Chisholm and a lot of these staff officers. But unfortunately, what they had done when they printed the book, they cut out various parts of it. And they got little dots, you know, to show you where they cut it out. And a lot of it's missing. And a lot of the April the 7th stuff is missing. And if you compare, for instance, Chisholm's, A.R. Chisholm's report, it's about twice as long. And it's got a lot of stuff that's cut out that's really, really important. And that's the kind of stuff that you start to get piece together this idea that Beauregard has this elaborate attack. It's supposed to take place with Breckinridge's corps moving forward. In fact, they tell Hardy over here on the right, watch, because the line is doing something like that. Watch, because Breckinridge is going to be moving forward and he's going to move across your front. Don't fire on him. And that's when Hardy's folks, you know, you saw in the movie Moore, John C. Moore and all that, they go forward and they're told that the next line up there is Confederates, and they get up there and they're not Confederates and they're fired on and all of that, you know, but they're told that Breckinridge is going to be moving across your front and you join in that attack. Is that you, John Seymour?
No. I was inside the Peach Orchard.
You got surprised that day, didn't you? Yeah.
No.
Oh,
you were federal.
Oh, you're federal.
Yeah, we were in the woods.
You surprised them. Okay.
Yeah, we surprised them.
That's Nelson's division. You're part of Nelson's division there. So even by 9 o'clock or 9:30 on April the 7th, Beauregard is still thinking, we're going to drive these folks. We did it all day yesterday. We're still going to drive them, and we're going to push them into the river and win the victory.
So who moved first, Buell or Wallace?
All right, that's a debate that's been going forever and ever and ever. Wallace starts, the first shots are Wallace. Right at Dalton. Thompson's battery opens up on Ketchum's battery across Tillman Branch, and there's artillery duel there, and then Wallace moves forward. That's the Pond is the only brigade that remains online contesting Tillman Branch. Everybody else, the other 15 brigades of the Confederate Army, fall back. He just didn't get the memo. He didn't get the word, you know, and he says, well, I'm out here by myself. Very quickly, he will fall back. But the only reason there's fighting over there, Nelson moves out just as early, but as we've seen, there's nobody to fight with him, to contest him, until he gets all the way to Cloudfield and there's a little skirmishing here. So that action is really the beginning, the first action. And if you read Beauregard's reports and his staff officers' reports, Jacob Thompson, for instance, talks about we were first indicated that Buell was here and there's fighting over on the right or over on the left. And then we get word that Buell is in on the right, and that's where the heavy push, and that's Nelson and company moving forward. But then they say that very quickly, Nelson and Buell, all of Buell's forces are stopped. I mean, they're stopped cold in the Peach Orchard and Wheatfield and all that. And the only people really making progress is Lew Wallace. And that's because earlier today in Crescent Field, you remember I talked about they kept flanking. Two times they would flank that Confederate line and it would fall back to another line. While this portion of the line, again, we kind of got to get this swinging thing. If the Confederate line over here is facing Buell and this is facing Lew Wallace, the line continually clocks back. This one's staying in the same position and this one moving back a couple times. And that's because Wallace keeps getting on their flank and moving them back. So you know, the fighting potential for Nelson here, sure, they're trying to push him back, but it's not the overwhelming avalanche that we think about, that they just move forward and didn't stop. They get stopped cold and they actually have to pull back some. They're actually driven back in Confederate counter assault.
Happened to the Confederates on the first day when they ran into the initial line and everything kind of came to a stop.
Exactly. But it happens another mile out. I shouldn't tell you that we got another mile to walk, but it happens there instead of, it should have happened here had the Confederates put all this together during the night, which, you know, Grant was on top of it during the night, Beauregard wasn't.
What do you think when Forrest sees field troops come across, and this may be like screaming headline news, like it's the one thing, it's the worst news they could get.
Right.
And everybody he goes to basically just brushes him off and says, go find Beauregard, go find somebody else. Okay. It's almost like, it's not that they don't care, but.
It's hard to believe it. I think they're so convinced in their minds that this is not going to happen, because Beauregard got that message from Corinth that said Buell is in northern Alabama,
right,
and all of that. Forrest is not the only one. Heck, Benjamin Prentice is sitting in the tent at Shiloh Church saying, you wait till tomorrow, we're going to lick you tomorrow. You know, oh, you're not, you're lying, Prentice. You know, I don't know what the ramifications of a high-level federal general giving out intelligence like that. You know, he might have talked a little more than he should have. But
my thinking on that is that he was still wound up from the fighting in the Hornet's Nest, and my thinking is it's the only thing he had left to fight with was words.
Well, that's a good point.
He felt that they were kind of mocking him or laughing at him.
So I'll get you. I'll show you tomorrow.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Concerning Forrest, of course, you know, he goes to all these generals, and we have to remember Forrest is just a lowly colonel, but, and I wouldn't say that to a staff ride when Colonel Grant, you know, but he is just a colonel with a whole bunch of generals running around here. He wasn't a West Pointer, yeah, exactly. And you know, are we going to listen to one little colonel that's blowhard, you know?
If it had been Forrest in 1864, maybe.
Had it been, they would have might have listened a little more, but this is not the Forrest. Good point of 1864.
It's very mystifying, because I'm thinking if somebody comes to me with a report like that, I'm going to check it out.
Yeah.
But of course, yeah. we
they're on the scene.
Yeah, I think their mindset is just, so we've got this victory won, yeah. We just mop it up.
You believe the lie, believe the lie, you begin to believe it.
Right, yeah.
I can't remember who the gunner was, or who the captain was, but under the story, there was a guy that was paroled out of
the ground. And people trample all over the party, and we'll let you pick a little fire.
This is the director for the movie?
No,
Stacy. Oh, Stacy, really?
Well, you know, on the hikes, a lot of times we do. People always put little wood boxes in their
head. He didn't like that.
He's probably having a bad day.
Is there any fighting first day through what we're walking here? Or have they switched over that way?
In this area, no fighting per se. The farthest you're going to get fighting is up around the peach orchard. To orient you, see Wicker Field right up through there? We're not that far from Wicker Field, the Missouri Monument, just right there. What you will get is some retreat through this area. First of all, of Stewart's Brigade that's held this left flank that the Civil War Trust is buying the land and all that. They'll retreat through this area. Chalmers, will follow. And in fact, part of Hurlbut's division will retreat through this area as well. When Hurlbut falls back from his line in the peach orchard, he'll bring his right brigade, Jacob Lawman's brigade, over to the west side or east side, left side of the river road. And they will man this position and then fall back through this area as well. And then, as we talked about on the other side of the battlefield, remember the wings that fold in, where Claiborne is trying to fold in but gets caught by resistance out there. Chalmers and Jackson's brigade will funnel through this area, and they're not fighting. Of course, they're maybe taking pot shots at somebody that happens to, you know, be struggling up a hill or something. But as a general rule, they're just moving through this area, wheeling by and large to the left to get around the hornet's nest up there. I've lost
both of my shoelaces here, so let's break me that. But you can see Wicker Field over there, and kind of orient yourself with that. Just up forward will be Almond's brigade line. We'll see that, and then we'll move on over.
But the first real contact will be here at Wicker Field. That's when Nelson kind of stops and deals with Chalmers' skirmishers. It's a little more than just Forrest Cavalry now. Chalmers has his skirmishers here. And this is the famous incident, of course, where Ambrose Bierce talks about, you know, the fighting in Wicker Field, and you can read more about that. The 9th Indiana, that's Hazen's brigade a little bit farther over. We're still moving diagonally. Bruce, at this point, is still on this side of the road, and he'll eventually move on over. Confederate resistance in this area is Chalmers' brigade. It really gets dicey and confusing. Jones Withers, and I've never really figured this out, for some reasons Jones Withers has most of his command in this area moving rearward to take a position farther back when Chalmers is up front here. And actually Beauregard, one of these staff officer reports that's not printed, but the rest of it indicates that he sent one of his staffers and wants to know why Withers is withdrawing when Chalmers is advancing, you know, and tells them to come back. So there's some convoluted stuff going on out there that I hadn't really figured out exactly what's going on. But Chalmers, Mississippians are the main resistance out here. Robertson's Alabama battery is up along the Hamburg Purdy Road, and it will be firing into position here. And remember, Nelson has no artillery at this point. They left their artillery in Savannah because you couldn't carry it over land and across the river. So they have no artillery support. There's other Confederate artillery out there, and if y'all want something to take as a project on your discussion board, if you can find out what the other artillery, Confederate artillery, I know Robertson's battery's out there. McClung's battery is just a little bit farther toward the west, but there's other artillery out there. I found one indication that part of Sweat's battery may be out there, Sweat's Mississippi battery. That was a diary or something I found that said we were with Chalmers on the second day. But the indication is there's a lot more artillery than just Robertson's Alabama battery, and Reed couldn't find the information to mark it out there, and I haven't seen anything really that indicates the what it exactly was. If you got any knowledge on that,
I would love to see it. One of our board members is real heavy into artillery, and he's actually,
oh, really?
To help himself learn about the battle, he's writing like his own version of a book about it to try and help himself understand,
oh, really?
It. And I wish he could have been on this hike because he's always harping on that we need to talk more about the second day.
Oh, really?
Yeah, okay. He really is. So
ask him, if you don't mind, ask him who else supported Chalmers at the Peach Orchard, that, Sarah Bell Field, besides Robertson and McClung and Hodgson's Washington Artillery. We'll talk more about that. We know those were there, but we don't know what else.
Tim,
yes, sir.
Back to the 6 days since you're right across from Wicker Field. Hurlbutt pulls back, and he's lying through Wicker's Field, and there's a big fight there. Now, is that Chalmers or these guys that are wheeling, or who's
yes,
that?
It's Chalmers. The alignment of the Confederate brigades is, well, you have cavalry farther out. And you imagine getting cavalry. That's Clanton's Alabama regiment. Then you've got Chalmers, Jackson, Bowen, Statham's, and Stevens. And that's the alignment left to right out there. Bowen and Statham will move more forward. Statham really more forward. Bowen and Jackson and Chalmers are the ones that's kind of do the wheel here. Bowen is hit. He's wounded somewhere out in this area. Chalmers gets separated from his command and has to go somewhere else and catch up with him and all that. And Jackson's leading the effort. But they're the ones that link up then with Trebu and Russell over there that close the gap.
Well, but I'm talking about Hurlbutt. Now, that's a bit earlier than closing the gap, right?
Right, yeah.
They were going around his flank.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm talking about who attacks Wicker Field when Hurlbutt's still there.
Okay, well, what happens then, Hurlbutt's lying in the Peach Orchard, of course, the famous line there where you see the monuments and all that. That line will break at 2:30 or 2:15 Johnston's attack where he's wounded. They'll fall back to the north side of the Peach Orchard, kind of an intermediate line there, but then they'll fall back north of the Bloody Pond. And that line will contain the Richardson's battery will be in that, the Chicago Light Artillery will be in that, just in the southern part of Wicker Field. That's the line you're talking about. That's when Hurlbutt brings Lawman's brigade over from basically connecting with the Hornet's Nest. He will bring him to this side of the River Road and place him in line out here. And you also get some reinforcements, the 57th Illinois of W.H.L. Wallace's division, Sweeney's brigade, will come over here and go in on that line. That's about 4 o'clock. That line will break about 4 o'clock when Chalmers gets on that flank as well, and it will fall back. There's another stand made in the western part of Cloudfield where those artillery pieces are. That's Willard's battery and Richardson's battery. There's a short stand there. The 28th Illinois will make a stand in their camps. The 3rd OI will make a stand, but there's really not a formulated line there, but then they all go back through the gap to the landing. But I'll show you that line, that 4 o'clock line, and we'll talk about how Chalmers comes around when we get up there. Does that answer your question?
Well, is it Prentiss then who ends up through Wicker Field at the end? There's somewhere there's a line that.
I'll tell you what, I'll show you the line up there when we get up there, and we'll. I'm not sure I understand what you're saying.
I just read something that these Confederates were getting flank fire from the Union guys as they came up this side, which was one of the reasons why they had to turn and take them on.
Okay, that's probably Lawman's brigade. It's not a straight line. It's kind of bending back a little bit. In fact, if you look on the map here, I can show you kind of more Lawman's position here. Oh my goodness. There we go. This is Lawman initially here, Isaac Pugh here, and then MacArthur here. MacArthur has fallen back, of course. This line in Wicker Field, see these blue tablets and monument right there, that's okay. The 57th. See how they're kind of bending back just a little bit. They're not due south, they're more kind of southwest a little bit. But yeah, it's Chalmers. See three, 96 right there, that's Chalmers as he turns around this flank here and will hit them, hit this on the flank and make that line fall back about 4 o'clock. Is that what you have? And we're of course about right here, so we're not far. We'll see this burial trench and then on that.
Okay.
We'll show you more as we get up. All right, you see here the 6th Ohio, Jacob Bauman's brigade, Lieutenant Colonel Neil Anderson. 24th Iowa, you see their monument there. 36th Indiana will be on down. I believe it's on down. We're going to walk out. I think it's on the other side, isn't it? But this is Amon's position. You can see they've moved diagonally through here. And we're not far. Y'all see the car go by the road just a little bit over there? The Bloody Pond is just right there. In fact, you can kind of see the sun glistening off of it a little bit. So that's Wickerfield, and Bruce's brigade will be next, and then Hazen's next. Now this is where, of course, they put the monuments where the major fighting is. This is where Amon is stopped. Around the fighting, the skirmishing and so on is 8 or 8:30 or so. By 9 o'clock or so, they're stopped here. In fact, let's just read what it's... what time these, to this point on Monday, where it was engaged at 10 a.m., it says, supporting Terrell's U.S. battery. We'll talk about that in just a second. But they stay basically here. In this position, this is about as far as they get until about 2 or so in the afternoon. So they're stopped pretty much cold here. Now, Amon's brigade will make a charge across this little field. You remember there's a little field on the other side of the road from the peach orchard over there. They will dive off into that. That's kind of a burnt over area with some cabins in it. And the Confederates will counterattack. Thomas will counterattack and actually drive it back. So these folks are pushing forward, but they're actually being driven back to this line again. And that illustrates, I think, some of the Confederate offensive potential still left to be able to drive these fresh full units back across this terrain here. So that's Amon. By 2 or so in the afternoon, they will push on forward once Hardy will begin to remove his command, because the other flank keeps getting flanked. As a result, Beauregard starts drawing back, and the first things you're going to draw back when you got to go out one certain way. If everybody goes out to Corinth Road, certainly you want to get your far right flank out first and bring it back so that we kind of, you know, mushroom into, not mushroom, but de-mushroom, I guess, if you know what I mean.
Funnel
back through the main road here. And that will allow Nelson and Amon to move on forward. They are flanked out in the area, this rough terrain. We could go down in there if you wanted to, but I don't see any need to. They're outflanked out there. Actually, what happens is Nelson has to bring other troops to support them. The 2nd Iowa of Tuttle's brigade comes up of Grant's army and helps secure this flank. Nelson also, Buell has to bring over the 19th Ohio of Bull's brigade of Crittenden's division that's fighting in where the Hornet's Nest is. They bring them, for some reason, all the way around here to help secure this flank. So it's pretty iffy on this flank here. And really, you know, Chalmers, he's been shot up and all that, but he's got a little bit of advantage, because where did he fight the whole time the day before? He was right in through here the whole time. So he knows the nooks and crannies here, and he knows what can be done and how to do this. So he's got just a little bit of an advantage there. But the point is, Nelson is stopped. His left under Amon is stopped here for a lot of the day at the first resistance they actually get. Took them 2 or 3 hours to get here, skirmishing and all, and then they're stopped for 3 or 4 hours while they're here, and they only move forward when the Confederates start to fall back. So again, my point is, and I belabor this point, I guess, but it's not just the avalanche rollover that we sometimes think it is. It's a lot heavier fighting, a lot more important fighting.
Your point is well taken, too, about if they set up their line over by the ravine. I mean, if they can stop them out here on flat ground.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And I mean, you've got a little bit of lowland and so on over here, but by and large, this area up on the high ground is relatively flat, yeah, right. and you don't have any real defensive areas that's helping you out there. All right, let's go on over. We'll look at Bruce's brigade.
It's really about to play a major role. Let's probably put him in the
book. Turn a little bit, and Jackson will be farther out there, and then Chalmers even farther out, hooking around that left. High ground in the woods up there. That's where Robertson's Alabama battery is, and whoever else that we're going to find out who that is over there. And they're firing, of course, into Nelson's division as we're moving forward. Nelson will contact Buell and say, look, I've got to have some artillery. I left all of my artillery in Savannah. I've got to have some type of artillery. So Buell sends him two pieces or two batteries, two batteries. One is Terrell's U.S. artillery here. This is what the 4th battery, something of the 4th U.S. artillery. We can look at this. I don't remember. Essentially, Monroe tells us They arrive, they're attached to another division, but they send them straight out here to aid Nelson.
Okay, 5th
United States Artillery. Company H. Okay, they're attached to McCook, but Nelson sent them. McCook is on the other side, and Nelson or Field sends them out here to aid Nelson. The other, you see the monument, this is the U.S. regular artillery. That's the 4th U.S. artillery battery, what, H and M or something like that. It's the mine battery. They're going to be in Wicker Field. We're going to walk this line in Wicker Field in just a second. They're attached to Crittenden's division. Now, why have McCook and Crittenden been able to get their artillery here when Nelson was not able to?
They came by boat.
Exactly. So they're able to bring some of their artillery. The 3rd battery that is attached to Buell's Army that actually engages here is Bartlett's Ohio Battery. And they will follow Crittenden and McCook out, and they'll be engaged in what was the Hornet's Nest the first day. I guess it's the Hornet's Nest the second day, too. But at any rate, in that general area. So the batteries are pretty few and far between, and they locate them where they need them to be to aid exactly what's going on. And Terrell's Battery, I think it moves up a little bit, supports Ammon in the clearing out there, but they will be driven back as well. And I believe, if I remember correctly, it's been a little while since I looked at this, maybe they lose one gun, but retake it, and they lose a caisson, I believe. So there's some pretty heavy fighting over this artillery, and they have to fall back to this position. So this kind of falls in line with Ammon's position here. This, again, is where Buell is pretty much stopped for the majority of the day. Now, that's Bruce's brigade right here. Let's walk across and see that. Pretty much stalemated, 10:30 to 1. There's Bruce's brigade. What time is it given here? Engaged here at 10 a.m. They will advance a little farther into the peach orchard. There's some talk, and again, this is what leads me to believe there's more artillery here. Bruce and even Hazen say that their skirmishers capture a gun, a Confederate gun out there, and then they have to give it up and fall back, and there's some movement into the peach orchard and then back, just like Ammon moved into the little cleared area over there and then was forced back. Bruce is doing the same thing. But the point is they're not moving forward for several hours. Now, back on the first day, let's go back to deal with the first day. Lawman has been pulled over to that side from his position over here. The line is still skipping across here, though. You see Willard's battery, that's the Chicago Light Artillery. Battery A, the first. Peter Wood commanding that. You see back here, we're going to continue the line as we go on down into Wicker Field, and I'll show you where the line continues on. And then we'll look back to the second day. I know it's confusing y'all jumping in.
You keep it, Noah.
Well,
oh.
Just.
Okay.
So I was probably wrong.
Okay. All right, I may know what you're talking about. When Lawman is pulled out and moved to the other side of the road, that leaves a gap between Hurlbut and Prentice. And what Prentice does, if his line is like this, he will refuse this flank. And so it's a 90 degree angle like this when he refuses the flank like this. So yes, there is a line facing west. Is Prentice's people.
Right. Okay.
Is that what you're talking
about?
Okay, yeah. That's farther on over into the woods there near the Hornet's Nest, and it is marked. But that's not Hurlbut, but that is Prentice. Yeah.
And that's your fish hook that you're talking about.
Well, it is one of the fish hooks. We got multiple fish hooks. Next time you hear at Gettysburg somebody talk about fish hooks, tell them we got multiple. all right, back on the second day now. Hazen's brigade. That's Bruce up there. We talked about Bruce and Ammon. Hazen's brigade, you see the 9th Indiana here, that's Ambrose Bierce. They first become engaged on the other side of Wicker Field. Chalmers skirmishers at least, and maybe Chalmers brigade. And again, this there's more artillery out here. They actually report capturing a gun, the skirmishers do, and then they have to give it up as well. A different gun than what we were talking about with Bruce there. But you have to move them back, and then they fall back to the regular line on the Hamburg-Purdy Road, and they continue to fight their way through here. You see the battery H&M of the 4th U.S. Artillery. That's Mendenhall's battery, Terrell here, Mendenhall here. And then you see the Ohio monuments, and there's a Kentucky tablet on in there. That's Hazen's brigade. That's what we'll focus on kind of the rest of the tour, and we're just about done. 9th Indiana, 41st Ohio,
And then 6th Kentucky will be right in the woods. And then they will connect with Crittenden's division, Suey Smith's brigade, and then Boyle's brigade, and then McCook on next. Now, the key here is what you get. Which way have Ahman and Bruce been facing? Pretty much due south like this. But if you look at Hazen's brigade, he's facing more southwest. What this is a configuration in the Confederate line. If you look, and this is not the best map to show it, if you've got a read map, look at it and you can see it plainly. The Confederate line will basically be along the Hamburg-Purdy Road here, but then it will take a jog kind of to the northeast and will run more like this. So it's we can call even that a fish hook if we wanted to. But it's basically east-west here and then southeast-northwest here. So it's kind of got a jog there.
An oblique angle.
Oblique angle, that's a good term for it. So what Hazen is doing, he's facing, of course, is the angle in the Confederate line, and that's at the wheat field up there. So he's fixing to push off into the wheat field, and he faces this direction because he's meeting resistance on his right. So of course he has to, just like Claiborne and the Confederate line did earlier this morning, they have to compensate and move around. That's what what Hazen is doing. They've been moving south too, but now Hazen is meeting more resistance, so he's kind of bending back at an angle a little bit like that. Now that line will continue through what is of course the Hornet's Nest and on into Jones Field. That's the line that Wallace will flank, and it will fall back to the Hamburg-Purdy Road. It'll be all the way across the Hamburg-Purdy Road. Wallace will flank that as well, and that's when the whole thing has to kind of start moving back. And there's a third major line then around Shiloh Church. And then Beauregard will set up his last line of defense south of Shiloh Branch, and then they will fall back. So that's kind of the larger context. All right, any questions on Bruce or Hazen? All right, let's follow Hazen on through and his attack at the wheat field. Some of the most famous stuff is the second day gets any attention, it's normally Hazen and his attack on the wheat field. Move through the cabin area as they're moving diagonally this direction toward the wheat field. The 9th Indiana will encounter the cabin in this area, and there's some great accounts of cannonballs hitting the cabin and blowing logs on the men and splinters on the men. Of course, that's not this cabin. This cabin was moved here a couple of weeks after the battle. Vance George's first cabin was destroyed. So anyway, we're on the extreme left flank of Hazen's brigade as it's moving forward, so we're going to go on around. We'll take kind of an easy route through the field for now and see if we can scare up a forest. All right, this is the wheat field, Daniel Davis's wheat field, and it was a little bit larger at the time, a little bit farther that direction. You can look on your trailhead graphic. Tim Kissel did a really good job on you know, the former boundaries and the new boundaries. Of course, it's through this field that the right of Gibson's brigade will move as it's making those attacks into the Hornet's Nest on the first day. On the second day, the Confederate line will begin to turn and go toward the northwest. As we talked about, this is Hodgson's battery, the Washington artillery. Breckinridge will be in that area facing more toward the northeast. Now it's here, just kind of lay the groundwork, that Hardy gets this message. Beauregard begins to formulate this massive counterattack. Early in the morning, 8:30 or 9 or so, and he issues orders to Hardy to watch for Breckinridge. He's going to move forward. That's supposedly Breckinridge's movement that's going to move forward over kind of across the front of Hardy's position. Breckinridge kind of balks at this. In fact, he sends Chisholm back to Beauregard and says, look, if I advance, this is before Claiborne and the rest of them have come up online on the other side of Beauregard. If I advance, then my left will be completely open and in the air, and there won't be anybody to cover him. Beauregard sends back word, says, yes, go ahead, I will send units to cover. And that's when Claiborne and pretty much all of Hardy's corps form on that line up there. So Beauregard, or Breckinridge, begins to move forward, all three of his brigades. They tangle with Crittenden's division, McCook's division. Trebue hits McCook's division. Statham hits Boyle's brigade of Crittenden's division, and it is Bowen's brigade, of course, that moves across the
the wheat field here and is beginning basically to move forward when the Federals, Hazen's brigade, picks this up. And Nelson will order Hazen forward and the rest of them forward as well. And basically what you got is the hitting of two advancing brigades. Bowen will hit Hazen as they move forward, and they kind of glance off of each other a little bit. Bowen is moving toward more toward like this, and Hazen is moving more toward like this. But Hazen drives in, pushes Bowen back, and Hazen will actually move forward so far as to take Hodgson's guns, the Washington artillery guns. The 41st Ohio will be the ones that will actually take those guns. The 9th Indiana has encountered a lot of fighting around the cabin up there, and then they'll move forward. Of course, they're taking some flank fire from McClung's battery over there. The 6th Kentucky is engaged here, but there's a counterattack. This famous counterattack, of course, that occurs from the Crescent Regiment. That's their monument where the Truckee is over there. The 19th Louisiana is also involved in this. The 2nd Tennessee, Bates 2nd Tennessee, what's left of it. Getting back to Claiborne a little bit on the second day. Claiborne's not there, but part of his 2nd Tennessee is there. The 13th Arkansas Stewart's Brigade also will be involved in this counterattack, and they will then drive Hazen back to basically that line that we've seen with Almond, Bruce, and Hazen. And they basically just remain there for the rest of the day until Hardy begins to pull his guys out. The most vicious fighting on the second day occurs here, though, as we sweep across, back and forth across this wheat field. This is the heaviest fighting, you know, just saturated with blood. If you look at Buell's army, the heaviest casualties in all of Buell's army that day occur in Hazen's brigade. And that's indicative, of course, of the heavy fighting that occurs here. The Confederates retake Hodgson's guns and are able to withdraw them then from the battlefield, and they take another position a little bit farther back in probably Jones or Barnes Field out there. But eventually the division does move forward with Ammon, of course, still on the left, Bruce in the center, and Hazen here. They will take position. You see the tablets on the other side of the road. There's another one down. That's for Hazen. You see where Terrell's battery takes position on the high ground there, and they will fire into the Confederates as they fall back. A funny story about Hazen here. Right in the middle of this attack, though, Hazen basically gets lost. They see him riding away. And Nelson rides over and says, "Well, where's Hazen?" And everybody says, "Well, he was with us when we attacked him, but we don't know. He's gone." And they thought he was killed. And Nelson actually gives, I think it's like a $50 bounty. He says, "If you find his body or find him, I will give you, I think it's $50 or $100 or something like that." So they all go out looking for Hazen, you know, and finally they find him back at the landing. What happened to Hazen, I don't know. Nobody really ever says they like Hazen, but he kind of is a little bit AWOL there for a little bit. Of course, Hazen goes on to become very famous where?
Stone's
River, the Hazen Brigade monument there, where the burial plot and all of that. So that's the famous Hazen. But his baptism of fire, if you want to call it that, is pretty much here. He doesn't do so well.
He said he got lost. There were some other people that weren't so sure that he got lost.
Yeah, exactly. They wonder about what exactly happened. I don't think it was ever fully explained, but. Anyway, they were looking for Hazen. I think they give the command to Whitaker of the 6th Kentucky, I believe. And it's Whitaker that, if you read his report in the OR, it's funny, he writes in third person, their colonel moved forward and stabbed one of the cannoneers at the cannons with a bowie knife, and that he had taken off of a soldier that he had captured or something. He really blows himself to be up big, their colonel and all that, you know, and he's writing it about himself. So. There's some pretty good characters in there.
Do you know if Nelson had to come up with a $50 to $100 for somebody?
They never found him here. They later on, I think it was after the battle or that night or something, they find him back at the landing. I believe you remember the story that where they find him. So I don't know that he ever paid up.
Over for the day. Somebody from the division or some regiment in his outfit tracked him down.
Yeah.
Said, "Oh, they've been looking for you."
Nelson seems to do this, though. It's Nelson on the advance to Corinth. And I talked about the Widow Surratt and the fighting there, the ford of Phillips Creek. And Nelson is supposed to move forward, but he can't until this ford that's guarded by the Confederates is uncovered. And that's on a different brigade. I forget whose it was. But Nelson goes and bets that brigade commander that he can't take that forward or something like that. And the brigade commander says, oh, we don't do that. So Nelson sends his own guys, this Bruce's brigade is under Cedric then, and they go and they take the forward, and it's pretty heavy fighting there, and they lose some men and so on. But when it's all said and done, they make Nelson give them that barrel of whiskey that he had promised to that other brigade because he had sent them. They said, Nelson got us into this, he should pay us the barrel of whiskey. So he does. So he has a tendency, I guess, to promise things, and sometimes he just comes out. He is an interesting character.
Of course, he wanted to, when he found out the situation with Grant's army, he wanted to get across the river like right now.
Oh, yeah.
And Grant said, no, don't worry about it. You come Monday or something like that.
Oh, before battle. The battle even occurs. Yeah. Nelson's ready to come across and move on, and Grant says, well, you know, we won't have transportation until Tuesday, I believe. Nelson says, well, okay. But actually, they're coming in at Hamburg anyway. They're not going to be ferried in right here. The Hamburg is allotted to Buell's army. But he wants to be on the same side of the river. And that goes into the whole surprise thing. You know, if Grant was expecting a fight, if he knew he was going to fight here, he wouldn't have told Nelson, we can move you on over Tuesday. You know, so all that about, you know, denying a surprise, that's a much.
Well, he kind of owned up to it without actually owning up to it.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
The way you write, Sam. Sherman's kind of the same way.
I think they could see the futility of arguing that it wasn't a surprise, because
it's ludicrous. Right out and admit it.
Tim, in Hurlbut's report, I think it's his report, when he talks about moving up on the 6th, he talks about the Wheatfield Road. There was a road going through here?
Well, he writes that in his report. I don't recall that in his report. I would have to look at it to see exactly.
Well, somewhere I ran across Wheatfield Road.
Yeah.
And there's a little trace on the maps, but I was just wondering about it.
Well, I
thought he came down.
He comes down the river road there.
At one point,
somebody
he sends them down the Wheatfield Road.
Well, it could very well be. The thing about the road names then, and creek names as well. You get all kind of different names for these creeks, Oak Creek and Briar Creek and all of that. The roads get really mixed up in terms of names and so on. They come up probably with some of their own names. Was it capitalized Wheatfield Road?
Yeah.
Or is,
it, yeah,
was
I think it was.
The one running diagonally across.
Diagonally across here. Could be. There's a lot of reference to this road. The Hamburg Purdy Road is the Bark Road. And we all know the Bark Road is the next one down on the high ground out there. But a lot of references to Hamburg Purdy here is Bark Road. So it's difficult to really know for sure what anybody means when their road names are so jumbled up. Kind of have to read between the lines there.
On Beauregard's counterattack that he was thinking about on the second, or formulating, where you're thinking he's kind of bringing, normally he's bringing his left.
Left hook again to drive them into the river. Yeah, he's still thinking river.
You think maybe it was because Buell's advancing along that side of the battlefield that might have caused him to just try and hit them in the flank and drive them back in?
Probably so. I think he realizes, I'm not sure they know much about Lew Wallace and him, where he's marching in and so on. That's kind of a phantom thing out there. And two, that's just one division, not an army.
Right.
So I think Buell's mindset is that is the key threat, an army coming in here. And if we're going to do anything, we got to sucker punch it to the left. Of course, he doesn't count on Lew Wallace. And really what turns out, Lew Wallace is the key that unlocks everything pretty much, because these Confederates are holding here. And it's Wallace that keeps unlocking these various lines. And I think Beauregard is fixated on Buell, because that's the larger threat, and the obvious place that he's going to come in is the landing. So everything is pushed that direction.
And you ran into Grant's army.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Anything else on Nelson? That was a little quicker, not quite as rugged. A little bit as rugged, but not quite as rugged. But our vehicles are at the Peach Orchard, of course. Aren't you glad we don't have to walk back to this one? Good thing there. What time is it? Yeah, if you want to go back through the
3:45.
All right, we got an hour and 50 minutes, or I'll stay to dark. I'll stay as long as you want to. You were more interested kind of in the park history type stuff.
If we got time.
If you want to do that, I'm all game. If y'all want to look at some of that, we can. I tell you what, we can be walking. Let's go ahead and be walking back. But tell me some of the stuff. I don't have anything. Just I don't have stop program that we're going to go here, here, here. I want to go where y'all want to go. So some of you tell me some things that y'all have heard about and want to see. I know, like that you'd mentioned the former superintendent's residence, the log house out there.
You mentioned stuff up a little around the landing, some of the buildings that you have around there.
Yeah, we can look
there.
At a little bit of that. That won't take long.
Some of the stuff we got when the tornado came through.
Okay, yeah.
Maybe out by Old John's Outlet. I was going to say the Duncan house over in Duncan Field. How about maybe the side of the Old Union Church? Is it over by the Michigan Monument?
Mm-hmm. Well, now there are two different churches. I thought you were talking about the one, the northern branch of the Methodist Episcopal Church was just north of Shiloh Church. They were within the the pre-battle church split, and then the southern branch of the Shiloh, yeah, that was around the Michigan Monument. But I don't know, I don't know specifically where exactly. I couldn't pinpoint where it was.
The city has it kind of right in here.
Is that right?
It was missing the river.